Welcome to the Great Lakes Stormwater Collaborative Webinar on Manufactured Stormwater Treatment Devices. Thank you for joining us this afternoon or morning, depending on which time zone you're calling us from. We're glad to have you. Chris Allen and Philip Taylor are going to talk to us today about manufactured stormwater treatment devices, what type of options are out there, and how they can fit into sort of overall stormwater management. So we're so thrilled that they're joining us. Just a couple of logistical items before we get started. This webinar is being recorded, just so you know, so it'll be posted on our website. We did have a webinar in July on stormwater retrofits, and that was also recorded, so I'd encourage you to check that out if you're interested. Everyone on the line is muted, and we're going to ask folks to stay muted just to reduce background noise, feedback, things like that. There will be an opportunity to ask questions at the end, and you can see there's a chat box in the lower left corner of your webinar screen. So you can use that for questions for the presenters, or if you're having any logistical issues, you can also type questions in and we will work to address any sort of technological or logistical issues. So with that, I think we will go ahead and get started. Thank you again. And so just a real quick background on the Great Lakes Stormwater Collaborative. The Stormwater Collaborative is a multi-sector network of stormwater management stakeholders led by a volunteer leadership team. And the leadership team comes from, what we kind of consider both the supply and demand side of stormwater management. So the vision is to advance the adoption of stormwater technology and practices. And one of the things that we identified is that this gap between supply and demand can be one of the places where we that's really stopping the adoption of stormwater technology and practices. So that's the goal of this group, and this webinar is really just kind of a piece of the overall puzzle. So that is who we are, and we're so thrilled to welcome our speakers. As I mentioned, Philip and Chris will be speaking us to it today. Philip Taylor is a New Zealand trained and registered civil engineering associate and certified professional in stormwater quality. Phil started his civil engineering training in floodplain management, river and foreshore erosion control as a field survey assistant with a water and soil conservation authority, progressing to water supply, wastewater treatment, stormwater and transportation infrastructure projects in New Zealand and the United Kingdom, later moving to construction projects, manufacturing, sales, and marketing. Working as Hydro International's technical product manager for the Americas Stormwater, he now works throughout North America to manage regulatory approvals and design assistance for proprietary treatment systems and flow control to regulators, municipalities, consulting engineers, and developers. So we're so glad to have him with us. After Philip, Chris Allen will be speaking. Chris is a regulatory manager for Contact Engineered Solutions. He has a BS in Civil and Environmental Engineering from the University of Cincinnati with focused coursework on water resources. Chris began working for Contact as a stormwater design engineer, specializing in stormwater treatment and detention design. As a regulatory manager, he now works in the Great Lakes area to manage regulatory approvals as well as provide technical assistance for stormwater products to regulators, design engineers, and consultants. So thank you both. We're so glad to have you. And with that, I will hand it off to Phil. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Margot. And I'd like to thank everyone for attending as well. I much appreciate your time. I know your time is valuable, and I hope you'll get a lot out of this presentation by Chris and myself. Let's see if I can get the presentation working here. Okay. All right, so I'm going to introduce the webinar, and Chris will expand more on the green side, but I'm going to talk a little bit about the green, the gray, and the LID, and how that incorporates into manufactured stormwater devices. So it's not always the best relationship between the green and the gray. It's been a contentious issue over the years, but I think we're getting to a point where we're starting to understand each other a little bit and realize that actually it's a total solution. In researching a previous webinar I had done for Hydro International, I did it a couple of weeks ago, themed around the grey and green stormwater treatment systems. I did a bit of research. I always like to go back and look at the history of things when I'm preparing for a webinar. And what I found when I look back, there's a little bit of confusion, and understandably so, because it's easy to confuse the two. But green infrastructure, or GI as it's called, and low impact development, or LID as it's called, have become a bit of a confused set of things. And so I went back and had a look at it. And green infrastructure originally developed, the term came out around about 1994 in Florida. And it was a report that looked at the disconnection of open space, of green space, and how it's been carved up by development, and the benefit of reconnecting that green space together to provide continuous areas of land for ecology, for movement of animals and that sort of thing. And that's where the green infrastructure came in, and they realized that green infrastructure was equally as important as gray infrastructure in terms of retaining a healthy, healthy environment, healthy systems. And then at about the same time, in the early 1990s, the low impact development movement was coming along as we were starting to address hydrology. And so we have this low impact development, which is a hydrology model and works on a site level. And we have green infrastructure, which is an ecology thing, and it works on a landscape level. And the EPA managed to actually confuse the two terms in 2007 when it started to refer to green infrastructure as a collection of low impact development on a site to produce a global sort of design for a site, which might be a large commercial site or commercial development. So the term green infrastructure became interchangeable with low impact development. Now, this is where the unintended consequences come in, and you introduce the word green into things, and that became a synonymous sort of thing. Well, if it doesn't look green, i.e. doesn't have a plant in it, maybe it's not low impact development. When in fact, when you look at it and you look at the definition of low impact development, which is a hydrological model to restore a site's hydrology back to pre-development levels, there's nothing mentioning green in low impact development. It's a whole toolbox of products and practices that develop this low impact development. And so when we look at our systems, our gray systems, we're trying to mimic using the systems we have that pre-development condition. So some gray systems work better at things than green systems or low impact development. Some low impact development works better at other things. So the two can actually work quite closely together. And one of the primary objectives of low impact development is reduction of runoff rates and volumes, to infiltrate where possible, to minimize pollutant loads on receiving waters. And really there's no limitation, or should be no limitation, on how this is done. We can find, unfortunately, many references in stormwater manuals, especially recent updates that use green infrastructures instead of low impact development wording. And that kind of steers people in one direction or eliminates better options in another directions because of the GI wording, whereas really the intent is low impact development. So I'm going to just go through and look at this a little bit more. So when we have a development, we really have two objectives. We have the water quality objectives and the water quantity objectives. So we're trying to deal with the volume and we're trying to deal with the quality. If you were on my presentation a few weeks, 2 or 3 weeks ago, I talked about where all this came from, and the picture on the right is basically a product of a couple of law changes or bills that went through in the mid-century. One was the Real Estate Investment Trust, and the picture you see on the right is a multi-tenant commercial real estate investment trust. And the accelerated depreciation laws, which allowed developers to rapidly depreciate the value of greenfield development. to substantially reduce the financial risk of doing a development in greenfields. And basically, the shopping malls exploded and greenfield development took off. But in that time, there was no corresponding water quality regulation. So we have a tremendous amount of this commercial development and paving over green space with very little water quality control going along with it. And that's when the Clean Water Act came along in later years to try and fix that. So, you know, the first people on the scene were the grey infrastructure guys. And when we look at pollutants, we find there's a lot of pollutants out there. Primarily, we're looking at sediment or total suspended solids. Nutrients are becoming a substantial focus of water quality treatment, and that includes the phosphorus and nitrogen. Trash and debris are becoming an increasingly focused area of treatment as well. California, anyone with beaches, anyone with areas where people spend a lot of time near water, the trash and the debris are a significant pollutant of concern. Temperature, that's a major pollutant of the concern. I've seen many developments, well, not developments, but projects going in around where I live in Wisconsin, where they're trying to eliminate dams and stuff which were created for industrial use in the mid-century, but they're actually big heat sinks and heat the water up, and they're trying to get the streams back down to their original temperature by eliminating the dams. Of course, people who have properties on the side of these dams don't really like that when you start taking away their lakes. But this is a temperature issue. Chemical pollutants, metals, pesticides, all these come into it. And it's very much a matter of matching your treatment system with what you have to treat. So just to put in context, that photo that I took to show you the influence of this, here we have the photo up the top left here. I took that on a cycleway in Kentucky, down by Lexington, Kentucky. And you can see I was in crossing a bridge there, and I looked over the side. And even on vacation, you know, being a water quality guy, I'm looking at the water all the time. My wife's wondering what I'm doing. And I'm looking down there and going, wow, look at all that. And then I looked at the map and thought, you know, I've been riding a fair way now, and I'm well away from the nearest road of concern, which was the State Highway 75 here. That's a mile downstream of State Highway 75. And then it's at least 1.5 miles further upstream to any other development. And there's a commercial development at the Oakwood Estates there. So that's the source area for this pollutant. But that's just one snapshot of one piece of the stream. And that whole stream was full of this stuff. So it shows the influence, the impact of even a small amount of development on a stream if the source areas aren't controlled properly. So when it comes to targeting pollutants, we primarily think of sediment, and that can be graded from very coarse sediments, you know, greater than 1 millimeter or about 1/32 of an inch, and it gets finer from there down to the dissolved fraction, which is around about 0.45 micron, and really you're talking at subbacterial levels, single cell organisms type stuff, and the fine cells. So I'm going to look at the separators and maybe some of the filter systems, which work down towards about the 20 micron range, which brings you into the very fine silt range. Chris is going to talk more about the bioinfiltration systems, which can address other pollutants of concern as well. So when we think of traditional manufactured treatment devices, usually what pops to mind is the gray infrastructure, the swirl separators, they're often called OGSs or oil grit separators, hydrodynamic separators, swirl concentrators. We also talk about filters, but we don't think too much about modular green systems, you know, in the true gray sense, because then they actually have something green in them, often a tree. But when we have these, we have a range. We have the swirl concentrators, as shown here, filters in the middle. And part of that also is the screening devices now, which are coming in, baffle boxes with screens, which can treat high flows and screen out debris and other gross pollutants. I'm just going to look at the separators in this section. And the practical application of the stormwater separator, it really doesn't matter what brand you're using or whose model you're using. Separators, it's generally acknowledged now, work pretty well. In fact, they work really well down to about 50 micron, which takes you into the very fine sand type of range of material, ideal for cold climates, winter gritting, that sort of thing. And some of them do pretty well at gross solids as well. This is a shot inside a unit here, and you can see the collection of trash, bottles and stuff that's collected inside one of these things. And when you start to concentrate the pollutants in one of these, you realize just how much you have to deal with. And many of them do a pretty good job at free-floating hydrocarbons. And that's pretty much where these devices target. So coarser sediments, 50 micron above, gross solids, free-floating trash and hydrocarbons. Now, some devices have screens in them, and they will remove more of the neutral buoyant material, leaf litter and stuff like that, which you might have washing into these systems as well. Now, when you look at these systems, where they're placed is important. Separators tend to be best utilized upstream. So if we look at a system like this, where you might have a separator upstream, pre-treating to a storage system, that's a really good use for them. As any pre-treatment requirement, a separator is a good application for that. Then you go down to flow control, and then you might have an infiltration system downstream of that, or maybe a filter system. So separators are generally best used upstream. Now, there are cases where, and Chris will probably testify this as well, where engineers go, you know, if I put it downstream of the storage, I have controlled release, and I can use a smaller separator. Unfortunately, that's the worst place you can put a separator. And some regulations actually encourage this as well, because they want treatment before something leaves the site. And you've got a storage system upstream, and it seems convenient to put your separator just downstream before the water leaves the site. And of course, your treatments, your storage system up there is a big settling tank. It's pretty much going to load up with the sediment that really should be in the separator. So putting it downstream of storage is not ideal. It should be upstream. Another application of separators is just standalone treatment prior to going into maybe a stormwater pond. It's a place that concentrates the pollutants for easy cleaning. This is an aspect that comes into it. Maintenance is becoming an increasing area of focus in the stormwater industry. There are conferences now themed around maintenance, and I was at one a few weeks ago in Minnesota, and really the maintenance side and the pre-treatment of all systems is a critical aspect of long-term success. Just to demonstrate this, these are some of the ideas you might see out there with low-impact development. You put a curb cut in and you put the water into there. You've got an infiltration system there. And traditionally, you might have some riprap or some sort of form of just overland flow as pre-treatment. Unfortunately, that can block up and divert water away from the system fairly quickly. So you need fairly frequent maintenance on this to make sure the downstream system, the low impact development, the bioinfiltration system is maintained. Now, that was traditionally what was done, and we see now in this top middle photo here attempts to improve the inlet so that the sediment in the pre-treatment area is easier to maintain and works more for a long-term period. Now, you can see the capacity of that is not very large, so it's still going to require frequent maintenance, especially in a cold climate where we're gritting the roads and stuff. That can be filling up fairly frequently and need maybe monthly or 6 monthly maintenance. To the top right now, we see a different approach now. In this case, they've installed a small sumped catch basin there. You can see it's filling up with sediment now. It needs maintenance. But this is where grey infrastructure and green infrastructure start to work together a little bit and realize that, you know, the green infrastructure here or the low impact development really needs protection from this gross pollutant loading of the sediment, and that ideally you could actually have combined the downstream catch basin with as a separator device and brought it up to here, up to the screen here, and combine the two so that you can actually have a separator doing pre-treatment and maybe overflow treatment from the rain garden here, with the pre-treated water being discharged initially into the rain garden and then the overflow going to the outlet pipe. So a little bit of smart design. Chances are this was a retrofit situation where they've put this in later and this was not designed in initially with the subdivision. And also one aspect of the whole system of keeping these things successful and in long-term success, you've got to think about what's available. When you look at the O&M manual for a soil separator, the truck on the bottom left comes to mind. You know, go out there, lift the lid, vector it out, and you're good to go. Well, the O&M manual written for the curb cut system with riprap is a little different, and you can see that this is not a convenient system. This is time-consuming to rake and to pull out rocks. So if you've ever done pulled up a rock garden, you know how hard that is to do. So, you know, if this was modified to be a sump catch basin of some kind that it could be maintained with standard vector equipment, it's much more likely to be done more frequently, and which would actually give you more long-term success. It's a matter of designing for success, basically, and looking at what systems are available, what people are used to doing. Okay, so I'm going to, so that's the separators. Now, separators work pretty well with more systems as pre-treatment systems or standalone systems when you're looking at coarser sediments. When it comes to addressing things like total phosphorus, total nitrogen, very fine sediments, that's when we move into the realms of filters. So, you know, filters come in many variations. There are cartridge filters, modular filters, there are proprietary just plain filter vaults full of sand or some proprietary media, but they all basically do the same thing. They're looking at straining the water down to a much finer level of treatment. And filter with different media, there are actually two basic types of filters. There's a media filter, which contains some sort of mixture of sand, maybe peat, maybe some zeolite or perlite, maybe some organic compound to help remove metals and other pollutants. But generally, most media filters get down to about 20 microns, and they do pretty well with some dissolved pollutants. And the advantage of them is they can be changed, the media can be changed to target a specific pollutant. So if you have a site change and you have equipment on site that doesn't really suit the change in use, it's actually possible to change the filter material to target the new site use and any pollutants that might be produced. Now there's a second filter type out there called a ribbon filter. And this is fairly common as well, but this is a physical strain. Think of this like a pool filter. It's a membrane in the system. And it targets very fine material, and we start to move down to the sub 20 micron range. And this has come about because testing regulations now to get approval to use these filters, and Chris will speak a little bit more about the regulatory environment. But to get 80% TSS now, you really got to be able to remove almost all, you know, 20 microns and above, and some of the sub 20 micron material. And that really puts you in the realm of requiring a membrane type filter over a media type filter. Unfortunately, you know, membrane filters won't target anything that's dissolved. They really will take out particulate material, anything that sticks to the particulate material. But anything that's dissolved, you need to look going back to maybe a media filter of some kind. Now, where would you put a filter? This is where we flip things over. Now, if you go from the water flow from right to left, sorry, flip that, water flow from left to right, we have our pre-treatment system with a separator, your flow control, you might have an infiltration storage system there, and that would qualify for a low impact development type system where you're infiltrating stormwater and reducing runoff. You then may have a flow control device, which limits the release rate from that site. And now you get to the filter. Because you've pre-treated, and that's where the filter really comes in. And that's where you place the filter downstream of your storage system ideally, because it gives you flow control and buffering the flow, because filters are expensive. They tend to work at a lower rate of flow. So downstream of some sort of flow attenuation system is an ideal situation to put them in. Just some of the limitations of filters, and you know, they require a pressure head generally to drive them, and that may be from something like 0.5 foot to 2 or 3 feet to drive them efficiently to their maximum flow rates. They are sensitive to turbidity, so you know, the pre-treatment or to be cognizant of you know, construction runoff will just kill a filter instantly with the high turbidity, that sort of thing. So installing these on site, you don't want to install them while there's and then all the media in them while the site is still unsealed and is not established, you know, and you get a chance of getting a big slug of high turbidity water through. You may end up going to clean your filter as soon as the contractor moves off site and you seal it. Inlet concentrations and loads may require pre-treatment as well. Filters have limitations on area. Your source area could be a low concentration, but it might be a very high load of coarse material or something like that, which rapidly fills up the sump. So there are limitations on filters. You can't have 10 acres running into a filter and think you're going to be okay, sort of thing, even if the concentrations are very low. And again, I mentioned flow rates. They are sensitive to the flow rates. Generally fine with filters. We tend to treat up to about 3 CFS fairly economically. And once we get over that, filters get pretty large and pretty expensive. And most maintenance on these things requires confined space entry. So that's a consideration for the owner when it comes to maintaining filters. Most separators you can maintain from the surface. There's no confined space requirement. But when looking at filters, generally, there's probably a confined space entry requirement. Okay, so with that, I'm going to stop presenting my part and let Chris have his 15 minutes of fame. So with that, I'll just stop presenting here, and hopefully Chris can grab that and present his part on the green side of things.
Are you able to take over as presenter? Seems that we may have lost Chris, or maybe Chris, you are on mute. I don't know if. It looks like he's frozen, so we will give him just a second. He just sent me an email. We'll give him a second to get on. In the meantime, you can kind of think on Phil's presentation. If you have questions, we'll save those for the end, but you're welcome to chat those in now so that we have them and we can get all squared away. So we will just give Chris a second to get back in. For this hiccup here, folks. Chris is going to try to log back in, so I think he's going to quit and log back in. In the meantime, I guess, while we have this space, this wasn't really the plan for today, but I will tell you about one of the Stormwater Collaborative's upcoming initiatives until he's able to join us. So right now we're pulling together a spotlight map where we'll feature, you know, really innovative sites that are happening across the basin. So for us, when we look at innovative, we're looking at kind of unusual combinations of practices, whether they're green or gray, or a new type of technology that folks aren't really familiar with. And we're going to feature those, but we're also going to allow access for members to some of the real detailed information behind it, the drawings, the specs, things like that, so that it's a little easier for communities to be able to replicate those in their areas and have some of that real concrete information that sometimes we see lacking in other sort of site profiles that just have the big picture overview without those technical details. So we're really excited to be working on that. And if you have sites that you think would be good candidates, please feel free to reach out to us. I think you all saw emails from us, but you can reach us at glsc@glc.org. And so we'd encourage you to nominate a site, send it along, and then we can talk about, you know, kind of what that might look like getting it on the site. And hopefully Chris is able to join us here.
Hey, Margo. I seem to have been able to re-log back in. I don't know if you can... We want to try just somebody else moving the slides because I apologize for the technical difficulties, but it did not like me taking over as presenter.
I'm happy to advance the slides for you, so I will do that and you can take it away.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks. So again, sorry for that small interruption, but I will just move along as if nothing's happened. So. As Phil highlighted earlier, MTDs are generally regarded as gray infrastructure. You know, they're made of conventional construction materials like concrete, metal, fiberglass. They receive site runoff through pipe systems, and they generally treat runoff from the entire site in one centralized location. Because of that, they also tend to be large-scale treatment facilities, and you know, this is the category that our hydrodynamic separators and filters generally fall into. However, some of you may notice, being closer to the Great Lakes and in the Great Lakes watershed, often we have design requirements that push us towards a more green infrastructure-based approach. In general, when people think green infrastructure, they don't consider manufactured treatment devices because they're predominantly gray. And when regulations point to the use of green stormwater infrastructure, the desired result is usually a design that incorporates vegetation and other natural elements, sometimes volume reduction, a decentralized approach to treatment, and you know that generally results in small-scale BMPs. So MTDs like biofilters tend to bridge that gap between gray and green by providing all of those desired green elements into an engineered device. Next slide, please. So before we dive into biofilters, I just want to remind everyone some examples of traditional green infrastructure. This list is by no means exhaustive, but it does characterize some of the more common approaches to green infrastructure, of which most of us are pretty familiar. Most commonly, the natural and small-scale treatment designed to provide green infrastructure is some form of bioretention, a planter box, or a rain garden. And these tend to be the most visually appealing and community-friendly as well, which really helps their adoption of use. Next slide, please. So as a manufacturer, when we talk about biofilters, we're referencing devices like the ones shown here. Biofilters can be designed as flow-through filter devices or even coupled with infiltration or detention downstream of the device for volume reduction or other, you know, LID approaches. But biofilters are generally targeting the filtration of fine TSS, you know, that 20 micron range, dissolved pollutants as well, you know, between phosphorus and other nutrients, sometimes heavy metals. But you'll notice one key difference between these systems and the filters that we've previously discussed, and that each of these devices incorporates vegetation. This vegetation is not just a pretty gimmick that we use to sort of include ourselves in a green infrastructure bucket, but it's in fact an integral part of the function and longevity of the device. Next slide, please. So before we jump into treatment processes and how these things work, I just want to highlight some of the main common components of biofiltration MTDs. This image shown here is representative of the Filterra biofilter from Contech, my company. but you'll find similar mechanisms included in all manufactured biofilters. And I don't want you to think that, you know, filter is the only one out there, because we're all doing this. So starting from the top down, you've got your pretreatment layer. You know, in the example of Filterra, we use a top layer of mulch. And then below that, you've got your engineered high flow biofiltration media. And again, in Filterra's example, that operates at 140 inches per hour. That's much, much faster than you're going to see in your traditional bioretention systems. That's the point of calling that out, is these things are designed to be high flow systems. And then below that, you've got your underdrain layer or infiltration layer, depending on the design flow path. This allows it to be a flow-through device or tied into your LID practices if you're going to be infiltrating on site. In the middle of all this, though, you have landscape vegetation, and that's vegetation that should be chosen specifically to thrive in and be local to its destination environment. We want the plants to thrive in these biofilters, because when they thrive, they do their job. And if the natural elements of, you know, the destination location, so if it's really cold and the plant isn't hardy enough, it's not going to do its job, and these filters aren't going to be performing at the level we expect them to. Next slide, please. So as you might be able to expect, biofiltration MTDs perform all of the pollutant removal functions of a public domain bioretention system by the same mechanisms that we typically find in those non-proprietary systems. During the storm event, the various physical and chemical processes found in traditional bioretention systems that retain the pollutants also occur in biofilter MTDs. The top mulch layer provides most of the heavy sediment removal, some hydrocarbon adsorption, and some heavy metals complexing. The media's extensive surface area from its components of sand and organics provides absorption and adsorption of ionic waterborne pollutants by virtue of its cation exchange capacity, and that captures nutrients during the storm event. However, once the storm ends, biofilters keep on working. After the storm event, the microbes present, or microbes present within the plant root system, migrate to the adsorbed pollutants. They ingest them for their metabolic processes, and thereby remove captured pollutants while regenerating the cation exchange capacity to prepare the biofilter for the next storm. And that's what puts the bio in biofilter. And this is why, you know, we see the vegetation component as an important part of biofilters, and not just a gimmick. Next slide, please. So we talked earlier about the confusion between green infrastructure, low impact development, and depending on the goals of your local stormwater regulations, you may need to or want to provide some low impact development design on your site. Just an example of how biofilters can be used in LID design, you know, we've got a lot of creative scenarios that can address the tenets of LID design. You know, for example, the image on the left shows a Filterra used in conjunction with upstream permeable pavers. These pavers provide runoff reduction needed for the site, and then they will direct the flow to the Filterra for subsequent treatment. The image on the right illustrates a Filterra integrated into the landscaping. You know, we may see in LID design, you know, requiring that the stormwater management be built into a natural element, kind of like the landscaping. By piping the flow into the Filterra rather than a curb inlet, it can seamlessly blend into the landscape box without requiring, you know, that curb cut inlet, without becoming that concrete visual that people aren't really looking for in their green infrastructure or LID. So these are just two examples of how we've used manufactured treatment devices to provide green infrastructure and low impact development. There are other ways to accomplish these same goals with all the different types of technologies we've addressed previously. It's really just a matter of thinking about your goals and how you can achieve them with all the tools in your toolbox. You know, not everything that says green infrastructure necessarily has to have a green component. A lot of times it's really nice and a good benefit to do so. And if you've got that, you know, these biofiltration devices can help you fit that bill. Next slide, please. But what sets biofilters apart from traditional bioretention or other non-proprietary green infrastructure? Well, in general, biofilters are designed with that high flow media, like I mentioned a couple of slides ago. The proprietary media allows for more treatment in a smaller footprint when you're comparing to traditional bioretention and biofiltration. You know, your traditional designs will often operate in the realm of 5 to 10 inches per hour, and we're talking about 140 inches per hour, 100 inches per hour. You know, it's a pretty huge difference, and that allows you to take advantage of the hydraulic operating rate of these devices and really shrink your treatment footprints, which can come in handy when your site that you're designing is tightly constrained by space limitations. You know, as I mentioned in the previous slide, another tool in your toolbox. If this fits the bill for your site constraints, this might be something worth considering. Due to the nature of proprietary filtration requiring evaluation, these MTDs are proven and tested technologies. They're all evaluated by programs nationwide. There are also some state programs that are run as well for evaluation, but in general, biofilter performance is supported by rigorous testing and third-party monitoring, which is really helpful for giving you that level of confidence to understand that the MTDs that you're looking at are performing as advertised. And to ensure that consistent performance, we need to provide consistent media. You know, stringent QA, QC, and testing processes for media ensures this consistency and provides you with a peace of mind to know that this will operate, you know, at the level that you're expecting. And then also, because they're a manufactured device, biofilters are engineered as a system. This means that all the components are designed to operate as one, and they come as a packaged full design. You know, that could help you out in design time and even installation time as well when you're just getting, you know, a manufactured device on site and not really worrying about all the working components of traditional bioretention. Next slide, please. So as Phil discussed, you know, limitations of filters, biofilters also come with some limitations as well. You know, every MTD, there's not one that's going to be best suited for every scenario. So it's always important to consider if the one that you want to use is best suited for your site. Biofilters are generally optimal for small drainage areas. Since they're designed to treat stormwater at the source, the decentralized approach to treatment is ideal for biofilters. Given that they're generally providing treatment at the inlet, upstream storage for attenuation or even upstream pretreatment can be challenging. Not impossible, but it requires some good site conditions and some extra thought to do so. So keeping these things in mind when you're looking at MTDs as a tool in your toolbox, it's important to consider what are the challenges of your site and are those challenges suitable for the manufactured treatment device, or would you be more suited to a more traditional MTD, or sorry, BMP? Next slide, please. So now that we know about the different types of manufactured treatment devices and how they work, typically the first question on everyone's mind is, how do you know it works? Across the nation, manufacturers of stormwater treatment devices have submitted or are submitting their devices for rigorous testing and evaluation. Many of these studies incorporate third-party monitoring to provide balanced and fair reporting of the results. And currently, there are two major evaluation protocols for stormwater MTDs that are nationally recognized. They're highlighted here as the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection Certification Program, and then the Washington State Department of Ecology Technology Assessment Protocol, and that's commonly known as TAPE. So you may see references to these programs in your local stormwater regulations. I know that they're starting to pop up a lot more. They've become increasingly referenced nationwide, and the Great Lakes area is no exception. So I'll provide a quick highlight on these programs, but if you're really interested in finding out more, you know, please feel free to reach out to me or Phil after this webinar, or you go directly to the source and visit the program websites. I have some links here in the following slides, but they're also pretty easily searchable if you need that. So next slide, please. So New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection Certification Program is the one I'll start out with. This is one that I'm starting to see pop up pretty consistently here in the Great Lakes. It is a lab protocol and process that's owned by the DEP, but it's primarily administered by the New Jersey Corporation for Advanced Technology. And so that's a private-public partnership that allows some of the, I guess, process to be pulled off of the Department of Environmental Protection's, I guess, resources. So by having administration done by NJCAT and certification done by DEP, it's a pretty pretty well-established machine that certifies, evaluates testing for MTDs. So the two separate, I guess, protocols and levels of approval through New Jersey are separated at 50% and 80% TSS removal, that's total suspended solids. Hydrodynamic separators and settling devices are targeting that weighted removal of 50%. And that's generally because the New Jersey particle size distribution is a pretty fine particle size distribution, and hydrodynamic separators aren't really capable of consistently achieving that high level of treatment required for that particle size. So to achieve that 80%, we look at filtration MTDs, and those are designed to target that 80% weighted removal. Another benefit, or I guess part of the New Jersey certification, is the scour test component. And it's a mandatory part of filtration test, and basically it allows you to understand how it's going to perform in high flow scenarios. In general, New Jersey process is considered the gold standard for lab manufactured treatment device evaluation, and the data results are accepted in many places throughout North America. Next slide, please. Here's just a quick snapshot of what that certification list looks like on their website. The link is there below on njstormwater.org. But this is just a small portion of that list, just to give you an idea of how this looks. So you've got your stormwater treatment device, a link to the certification, as well as the certified removal rate, 80% for filters, 50% for hydrodynamic separators. Next slide, please. So moving into the TAPE program, is Technology Assessment Protocol Ecology. This is a field protocol and process that's administered by Ecology. The program includes a lab-based pretreatment standard, but what we see sort of nationally focused on is the, I'd say, filtration evaluation. There's three levels of approval for use level designation for that. So you've got the pilot, which is up to 5 installs and must be monitored. Your conditional, which is 10 installs and at least one successful TAPE study. And then the general level, which is an unlimited amount of installs. You can only do that after you've completed the field study. The general use level designation is the gold standard here for this program. If you've got that, you're approved for use. The separate approvals, there's a whole list of them. This is just the two that I'd like to focus on, because these are the two that I start to see popping up in the Great Lakes areas, sediment and phosphorus. Generally, we don't see a lot of metals addressed here in the Great Lakes, but those do exist as well for TAPE. TAPE is also the gold standard for field evaluation, and the data and results are also accepted in many places throughout North America. I know that Ohio references both in their regulations. Next slide, please. So here's just another snapshot of what that approved technologies list looks like. I've highlighted the basic tab here, which is the one that most commonly referenced here in the Great Lakes. That's your TSS. But this also lists your manufacturer, your device, and what type of treatment, as well as the use level designation. And again, the ones that say general use level designation are going to be the ones to focus on as your most evaluated and highest confidence level of performance. Next slide, please. So some of the challenges we see in manufacturer treatment device acceptance, nationwide, but also here in the Great Lakes, is really understanding where these devices fit into site design. It's important to consider what you're trying to achieve, and if, hydrodynamic separator or a filter or a biofilter fits into that design, or if you've got challenging site constraints, perhaps a traditional non-proprietary system won't be able to achieve those results. So just kind of understanding how that MTD tool fits into your overall toolbox of stormwater management is really important. And not understanding that has been a challenge, I'd say, for a lot of acceptance, just because it's like, well, why would I do something that does, you know, that costs more or costs a different amount but gets me the same? Well, sometimes there are challenges that can't be addressed by traditional practices. So you also have a confidence level in the performance of MTDs that can be a challenge. And you know, as I've just showcased, the ways around this are to reference these evaluation programs and understand that they're rigorous and widely accepted programs because they strictly evaluate the performance of manufactured treatment devices and with third-party monitoring, which is really important for balanced and fair reporting. Another challenge in that same vein is inconsistent evaluation performance. When you've got a program that doesn't consistently evaluate manufactured treatment devices, you find that different levels of treatment are being provided to meet the same goal, even though the different levels of treatment are not actually able to provide, you know, the same level of treatment. So hydrodynamic separators won't be equivalent to filters. It just isn't going to happen. And so understanding that difference and that, you know, if even if there's a set of data that says I get 80%, you know, for hydrodynamic separator, well, you have to understand for what particle size distribution, what kind of evaluation was done, was the third party tested? You know, things like that are really important to understand if you're looking at things on a level playing field. And that inconsistency has always been a challenge. And then, you know, finally classifying proprietary treatment as gray infrastructure in a green infrastructure focused environment is a challenge because, you know, we feel that we've got some green infrastructure ability with our manufactured treatment devices, but a lot of times it is just viewed as gray infrastructure. So with that, I believe that's going to wrap up that content. The next slide is our questions slide. So I think that if anyone has questions, we can open it up to that chat box.
Yeah, thank you so much, Philip and Chris. So if anyone has questions on specific products, uses, testing, anything like that, I'd encourage you to type them in the chat box. You can access that if you don't have it open with the little quote icon in the lower left corner of the screen. Chris, I guess I'll start with a question. Just that last point you touched on, talking about how proprietary products are typically considered gray infrastructure, but we see things like, you know, pervious pavement. Everyone kind of seems to consider that green infrastructure despite being very much not green. Do you have any idea of where those divides are made or why that might be kind of classified differently?
Yeah, well, I mean, just in my own personal experience, the divide comes pretty much along the lines that Phil had expanded on earlier, is where there's a confusion between LID and green infrastructure. And, you know, I think that permeable pavers definitely fall into green infrastructure because they help promote low-impact development practices. But that line across, you know, stormwater treatment rather than stormwater management definitely, in my experience, tends to be a more strict divide where if you're providing treatment and it doesn't have something green in it, well, it's like, well, that's not green infrastructure. And it's a hard time to show that, you know, it can fall into those same LID kind of benefits and practices. So mostly the divide I find to be, you know, in that treatment sort of realm of manufactured devices, but it, you, I mean, you're correct. The permeable pavers are viewed as green infrastructure in a lot of places, and I think it's because it's LID as well.
Thanks. Any other questions for Philip or Chris? And you can see their contact information is available here. We'll also be posting this webinar, and you're welcome to follow up with the Great Lakes Stormwater Collaborative as well at any time with questions, follow-up, or ideas for the future. Oh, there, we just got a question in from Joel Cohn. Are you familiar with the WEF certification? So it's presumably talking about STEP. Chris or Philip, would you like to?
Yeah, I can just chime in for a second on this one. So I think that both Phil and I are pretty well familiar with the STEP program, if that is what you're referencing with WEF certification. I didn't include it here because it's still growing as a process and still, you know, getting its legs under it. But eventually, you know, we would like to see that national program take off and as a good basis for strong evaluation across the nation. I think that, you know, I don't want to speak for Phil, but I think that we're all pretty excited for the opportunity of it.
Yes, I'd agree, Chris. The national standard is a missing link in the system, and it's been needed for many years. But with the development of STEP, I know STEP is looking at both, you know, the New Jersey and the Washington standards, the TARP and the TAPE, to provide some level of integration so that we're not all going back to testing again and starting all over again.
Great, thank you. So for those of you that aren't familiar, STEP stands for Stormwater Testing and Evaluation for Products and Practices, and it's really exactly what they're describing. So that's the program for those. We kind of just jumped right in, so sorry about that. That is the WEF program that I believe Joel is mentioning and would look to kind of have specific protocols and certification across the board. Any other questions before we thank you and let you go for the afternoon? We'll give it a few moments if anyone has anything else to type in here. All right, with that, we will say thank you so much. Again, feel free to follow up with either Phil or Chris or the Great Lakes Stormwater Collaborative in general, glsc@glc.org. And thank you so much for joining us this afternoon, and a big thank you to our speakers, Philip and Chris.
Thank you, you're welcome.